So let's now start something about Russian culture and Russian science. So, okay, let's go to the map of the world. Okay, what we can notice, Russia is the largest country in the world. Okay, yeah. If you now look deeper, okay, the area is about 17 million square kilometers. It spans across 11 time zones, so the time difference, from here to here is 11 hours, so quite wide country. Population is about 144 million. And in the recent year, Russia enjoys kind of positive growth rate, plus 0.2%. Before it was negative, which maybe is not very good, definitely. So as for the size, from south west to northeast, about 9,000 kilometers. So quite wide country, quite big, yet since it has not very big population, I think just somewhat greater than Japanese population, the density is very weak, about very small, about 9 persons per square kilometer. So plenty of space, especially here in Siberia. Yeah? Okay, if you now speak about population of Russia, capital is Moscow. Capital is Moscow, the biggest city in Russia. More than 12 million of people live here. The second city is St. Petersburg, about 5.3 million, just about 1 hour by flight if you fly from Moscow to northwest. Yeah, and what else? Okay, here I show the state symbols of Russia. We, I mean, all know this, yeah. The flag of Russian Federation with these three strips, white, blue, and red, and coat of arms of Russian Federation. So these colors, blue, white, and red, they are popular for Slavic nations. And if you look at the flags of Czech Republic, Slovak Republic, Slovenia, Serbia, Croatia, they all have these three colors in different combinations. Well, if you look at coat of arms of Russian Federation, you see here this double-headed eagle, then this Saint George who is going on white horse, who is killing a snake. And from here, I mean, from these symbols, we can easily trace influence of Byzantine Empire. Because in fact, the Christianity came to Russia in about, 10th century, and it came from Byzantine. So then a lot of things also came with Christianity, like a Cyrillic alphabet, like shape of churches, everything. So traces of Byzantine influence can be seen even now in Russian culture. Well, if we speak about, again, Russia in general, languages, well, people somehow are used to think, okay, Russian people speak Russian language. That's true to some extent. But Russia is a multinational state, and there are more than 160 ethnic groups and more than 100 languages spoken. Not dialects, but languages. And some of them can be quite far, I mean, from each other, so it's maybe hard to understand. Yet, of course, people use Russian as kind of a common joint language. Yes, and people who speak Russian, they also can somehow understand other Slavic languages like Polish or Czech or Slovak. Maybe not everything, but still possible to understand. What else? Something interesting, 25% of scientific literature in the world is published in Russian. So not a few, I would say. And if you speak now about scientific information, also all printed information, up to 60% altogether, sorry, I have to get used to this pointer, is printed either in Russian or in English. So if you know Russian, if you can read Russian, you can read a lot. Yeah. Well, what else? If now we just look at the country from the point of view of geography and nature, well, landscapes of the country. Since the country is huge in size, this big size, it just implies that we can see, we can enjoy a vast variety of landscapes, you know, different, you know, forests, you know, mountains, whatever else. And here also I show a few photographs. here. So it is kind of a typical view of what people call Middle Russia. About a few hundred kilometers south of Moscow, you have this kind of hills and slowly following rivers like here. Of course, you have forests, birch forests, which are nicely yellow in autumn, which are lively green in summer. Well, what also we have in Russia, okay, of course, winter. Somehow there is kind of stereotype, okay, Russia, Siberia, cold winter, lots of snow. That's true to some extent. So winter in Siberia, and okay, the temperature can drop down to minus 50, minus 60 degrees Celsius, pretty harsh conditions, yeah. But also we have mountains. So this is Caucasus Mountains, Black Sea and Caspian Sea in between, and they are pretty high, up to, up to 5,000, I think, 600 meters. So then the snow is always over there on the top. You can enjoy skiing even in July over there, yeah? But also we have plenty of things. Okay, typical birch forest. It is really, if you enter such a forest, you feel that you are somehow are at the center of light. Because of this white skin of birch trees, you really have a lot of light over there. Yeah, so kind of something very, very special. But also we have, okay, Siberia. It is something which you can, a similar landscape you can see if you just fly from Kansai to Helsinki. Because you fly over Siberia and you see that there is vast plain areas, no people, I mean no cities, nothing, just rivers and forests. Well, okay, and also a few photos which I found here quite recently. Okay, it is not far from Japan, Kamchatka Peninsula. You know, these nice mountains, maybe some of them may look a little bit similar to Fuji Mountain. Of course, not too much, but a little bit similar. Okay, also not a well-known place perhaps for foreigners, Altai Mountains. It is between Kazakhstan and China. And the climate there is similar to climate in Switzerland, a little bit, yeah. So also mountains, which are quite high, and a lot of forests. And also we do have some kind of sand dunes, also not far from here, close to Baikal, Lake Baikal. It looks like a real African or Arabic desert. So quite many things we can see. And since, again, the country is quite big, there are four very well-pronounced seasons. So springtime, summertime, autumn, and again this white winter with a lot of snow can be enjoyed in many places in Russia. Well, let's now speak a little bit about Russian architecture. What is a typical concept of architecture in Russia? Perhaps we have to start with churches. Because again, as I said to you, influence of Byzantine is strong in Russia. So some of those first churches, they date back to 10th or 11th century, pretty old. And here I show a few typical churches. So this is one of cathedrals in Moscow, Kremlin. And this is a very famous church, so-called Pokrova Nanerli. It is written here. It is a church from 11th century. So they all have kind of common features, this onion-shaped cupola. It is typical shape of Russian churches, and you also can notice some difference in the cross at the top. Catholic churches, they have just kind of simple cross. In Orthodox churches, there is also some kind of this extra things on the cross, yeah. Also kind of difference, you can easily spot Catholic church or Orthodox church. Well, some more churches also shown here, some kind of masterpiece in Karelia, about maybe 1 hour by flight from St. Petersburg, so-called Kizhi place. This is made out of wood, everything out of wood, and no single nail was used. And also pretty old, at least I think maybe kind of 500 years back it was made. And also the place which attracts a lot of tourists. Okay, perhaps one of the most kind of, again, picturesque churches in Russia is in Moscow, so-called Pokrovsky Church. It is just exactly on Red Square, center of Moscow. It was built in 16th century. So still it is in this very good, very colorful shape. And so now I think there is a museum inside of this church. It is not active church anymore. Well, of course, some kind of, again, this very famous pictures of Moscow Kremlin here, which was built with the help of Italian architects in, I think, in 13th or 14th century. So these towers of Kremlin with these red stars here, and also all churches inside the Kremlin here, shown in the picture. And this is a Moscow River, which flows just around the Kremlin. Okay, so it is a night view of Moscow History Museum, also close to the Red Square. I think it is just opposite of the Pokrovsky Church, Red Square. And it is this museum now does contain a lot of really interesting things, you know, artifacts from history of Russia. Okay, one more masterpiece of Russian architecture, Peterhof. Close to St. Petersburg. Peter the Great, famous emperor who ruled Russia at the end of 17th, beginning of 18th century, he moved the capital from Moscow to St. Petersburg. So a new city was just built up amidst nothing, just, you know, swamps and forests. And this place, Peterhof, is called sometimes Russian Versailles. This, you know, splendor of fountains, gold, and everything looks very impressive. So here also, what I show another view of this fountain. So this channel goes all the way to the Baltic Sea, which is just over here. Well, one more church is also in St. Petersburg and Peterhof. As you see in this shape, somehow we can trace maybe also influence of style from Italy, because also a lot of architects from Italy came. Of course, it is an Orthodox church. You see this shape of the cross, and again, this kind of onion-shaped dome. But all this kind of splendor, you know, this decoration, it just maybe look familiar to many churches in Italy. Well, modern days Russia now is kind of undergoing fast development and different things. So I show here the images of modern cities. So this is Moscow, so-called Moscow City, these skyscrapers and, you know, kind of, yeah, quite modern look. This is city of Grozny, recovered after all these sad events took place some time back. Okay, Kazan and, Yekaterinburg, so quite modern cities, which look kind of, you know, pretty modern, yeah. Okay, some words about Russian costumes. So these are the images of typical Russian national costumes in Middle Russia. So you see a lot of red color. This is also not kind of on chance or by chance, because in old Russian language, the word for red, it is krasnyi, which means red. It also had different meaning. Also, it meant also beautiful. So this kind of, you know, red color also meant kind of beautiful, special clothes to be worn on very special occasions, like, you know, holidays, like festivals. And that's why a lot of Russian costumes, they have a lot of red color. Okay, let's now go to Russian food a little bit, you know. Because again, a lot of things about the country can be said or can be understood if you look on what and how people eat. So since Russia is kind of cold country, and yes, it is indeed, winter is very long, so the food then should give to people enough energy and enough, you know, kind of warmth to survive through cold winter. And in old times, fresh vegetables, fresh fruits were, I would say, not often used. Of course, now you can buy everything in the supermarket, but in old times, no, forget about that. So the top five components of really say authentic Russian cuisine are as follows. Okay, potato, okay, in different, you know, forms, you know, baked, fried, okay, you know, soups, whatever else. Then bread, it is also a very important part of Russian cuisine. So in Japan people eat rice, in Russia people eat bread. Yeah, then eggs, meat, of course, because again, you can get energy from meat, pork or beef or whatever else in different forms, and also butter, because again, also butter can give a lot of energy. Of course, then what is also popular? Cabbage, you know, milk, mushrooms, okay, cucumbers, tomatoes, everything, yeah. But this is, I would say, something most important for the Russian cuisine. Also, a few images of typical Russian dishes, okay. What is known sometimes as, okay, Russian borscht or soup, or yeah. It is just kind of a soup with potatoes. Red color comes from tomatoes. You also can add here beef or pork or whatever, yes, and it's quite enjoyable, especially if it is hot, yeah, in cold winter, it's really enjoyable. Okay, another kind of, you know, iconic Russian dish is what is called in Russian blini or pancakes. Pancakes which can be served again with different, you know, fillings, with jam, with honey, with meat, with cheese, with everything, with tea, with coffee. It is also something quite tasty, although, of course, a lot of calories are there, yeah? Yeah, what else? Okay, piroshki, or pirosiki, as people call it in Japan, kind of these small little pastries, which also can be filled with everything. Okay, sweet stuff, salty stuff, potatoes, jam, fruits, whatever else, and yeah. Well, also kind of, you know, again, iconic food in Russia, caviar, or what is called in Russian ikra. Really something which people, I mean, kind of have or should try if they come to Russia, although it is now extremely expensive. Especially if it comes to this black caviar, it is really, I would say, extremely expensive, but yeah. Well, also kind of something kind of similar to kebab in Arabic countries, which is called shashlik. It is kind of combination of fried on open fire meat with different kind of maybe vegetables. So as you see, style of food is quite different. Yeah. Why? Because again, a huge country, you know, many people, many ethnic groups, many possible or available products. So the food is also quite diverse. Well, what about Russian souvenirs? Okay, again, typical iconic thing is matryoshka, or this kind of wooden dolls, which are empty inside, so you can open and you find another doll inside it. You open it again and one more, and so on and so forth. Then it can be up to maybe 10 or even more, you know, dolls. So you start with this big one and you end up with a very, very small one, like something you even already cannot cut it into two pieces. Yeah, then also wooden kitchenware, it is called hohloma, after the place where it is produced. It is made out of wood, and this typical kind of black and red color, and kind of also this yellow color, it is typical for this type of souvenirs also. What else? Also, now we go maybe to some more, okay, old stuff. Okay, this huge, sometimes really very big kind of teapots called samovar in Russian. Now maybe they are not so popular, of course, because it is maybe, yeah, okay, we have this, you know, this modern stuff, yeah? But people really used it, such stuff a lot in these old days. Also these painted trays for, I mean, to serve dishes, and some pretty expensive stuff here, so-called Fabergé eggs. This is the name of a goldsmith family in Russia, and they were producing this so-called Fabergé eggs, a lot of gold, a lot of, you know, precious stones. So all this stuff is really extremely precious, so maybe it's not easy to get it to your home private collection.